Hello, my friends. Welcome to the Church of the Apostles. It's an honor to have you. I hope that if you live anywhere near Atlanta, Georgia, that you would come in person. If we can serve you in any way, please let us know. Stay tuned.
I believe in God the Father, Almighty Maker of heaven and Maker of earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified and dead and buried. And I believe what I believe is what makes me what I am. I did not make it.
Making
Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to Church of the Apostles. We're really happy that you're here, and that's what we believe. We believe in a good God who's come to rescue us when we were running from him. He saved us from our sins, made us alive in Christ, and we look forward to a future with him. And until that day, we get to live an abundant life here because of him, showing the world the life of this one who saved us. And we're glad that you're here to celebrate that with us. He's great and greatly to be praised. So no matter what your week was like or kind of how you come in this morning, we encourage you to give your heart, lift your voice, sing your song, give him praise, give him thanks. He's worth it and you need it. Amen? Go ahead and stand up. Find someone around you. Tell them good morning. Welcome to Church of the Apostles.
Jason Maxwell comes to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, we do praise you this morning for bringing us into your marvelous light. With the psalmist, we sing praise to you. For your unfailing love for us is powerful, and your faithfulness endures forever. We give praise to you, Lord, for our lives and for your provision for us. We know that everything we possess is a gift from your hand. We praise you most of all for your Son, through whom your unfailing love and faithfulness has been made known to us. We thank you for his sacrifice that made possible our redemption and our reconciliation with you, and for the forgiveness of our sin that comes through your Son. Father, we know that if we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves. So we take time this morning to confess our sins to you. Forgive us, Father, for our pride, for our selfishness, for the ways in which we've compromised with evil, for our impure thoughts, for our greed. Father, forgive us for not loving you with our whole hearts and for not loving our neighbors as ourselves. Forgive us for what we've done that's contrary to your law and for not doing those things which you've commanded us to do. But Father, we thank you that as we confess our sins, you are faithful, you're just, and you forgive us our sins and you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Father, we pray for an increased knowledge of who we are in Christ. Help us to know that we no longer are under obligation to do what our flesh urges us to do. We do not approach you as fearful slaves. Instead, we've been given your spirit and have been adopted as your children. So we can come before you as our Abba, Father. For you are our good, good Father. And we are so loved by you. And because you're our good Father, you know what it is that we need even before we ask it of you. Yet you give us the privilege of laying our requests before you. Father, you, the Almighty God of the universe, majestic in glory and power, desire that we, your creation, ask to receive from your loving hand. So we do that this morning. We pray for the needs of this congregation. We pray for the marriages in this church, that you'd strengthen them, that you would reconcile husbands and wives. We pray that you would turn the hearts of fathers and mothers toward their children and the hearts of children to their parents. Pray that you would heal relationships that are broken, that you would heal bodies and minds that are sick. We pray for those that grieve, that they would be comforted. We pray for those in need of jobs, that you would make provision for them. Father, we pray for the staff of this church, that you would provide for and protect them and their families, that you'd strengthen them in the work of their ministry in this place, and that they would find their rest in you. We pray for our Rector Michael and his family, that you would protect him during his time away, that you'd protect his family, that you would continue to strengthen him and them for the work that you've called them to do. We pray for the staff and leadership of Leading the Way, that they would continue to shine the light of your gospel into the dark corners of our country and around the globe. We pray for this nation, that you would bring a spirit of repentance to the people of this nation, such that we would call upon you and seek you for our salvation. We pray for our political leaders, for President Obama, for our state and federal representatives and senators, for our judges, for all those in authority over us, that you'd give them wisdom, and that they would seek truth, and that they would seek to carry out justice in the many issues facing them today. We pray, Father, for your persecuted children around the world, for those who are facing the loss of possessions and the loss of their very lives, just for being numbered among your people. We pray, Father, for protection for them and for courage and for comfort. And finally, we pray for our brother Joshua as he stands to proclaim your word this morning. Pray, Father, that the words he speaks would be your words. We pray that you open our eyes, open our ears. We pray, Father, that our hearts and minds would be open to hear from you this morning. Father, we pray all of these things in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Tell me a little bit about why you want to come to the Gift of Sexuality Conference.
I'm so excited that Church of the Apostles is bringing this conference about human sexuality and biblical sexuality, because I think it is something that the church has been really quiet about. Where we are quiet, I really feel like the enemy has stepped in and been very loud. Intimacy is more than just sex. Intimacy is conversation too. A lot of times I think the enemy gets us alone and has us thinking, I'm the only one that struggles. And when you go to a conference and you sit around and you hear stories about what is actually happening in people's lives, it takes a lot of the sting and the shame out of it.
As I grew up, the main thing I learned about sex was that it was reserved for marriage. And that's true enough, but that's such a thimbleful of what the Bible has to say about human sexuality. And I'm so grateful that we're devoting an entire weekend of sound teaching to the topic. The cultural message to men in the area of sexuality is really premised on conquest. How young can I be? How many can I conquer? And it's a very thoroughly unbiblical view of sexuality. The biblical view of sexuality to men is to honor, to cherish. I think one of the topics I'm most enthused about is God's yes to sex. In Genesis chapter 3, God says, "The man shall leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. It's sacred. In our life, we had hurdles to overcome in the first year, and in the 10th year, and in the 15th year, and we're still learning, and we're still growing, and things are still improving. It's a God-intended, sanctified moment of intimacy between a man and wife that's not intended merely for physical pleasure, but it brings the supernatural benefit of a bond between a man and woman that's intended to last for a lifetime.
So, now that we have your attention, this area of our lives affects so many other areas, especially our spiritual lives. We all know this to be true. And yet so often, so many churches just don't talk about this area of life. And as a result, churches can sometimes be part of the problem rather than being part of the solution. And we don't want to be that church. So we're hosting this conference, The Gift of Sexuality. It's going to be on Friday night and Saturday morning, June 12th and 13th, less than 2 weeks from now. And you might be wondering, what are they going to talk about? So we want to show you. We're going to flash up some of the topics that we're going to be discussing here. And you'll notice as you look at this, that this conference isn't just for married couples. Many of the sessions are also relevant for single adults, college age and up. And while you're looking at that, I want to read to you a few of the comments that we got back when we hosted this conference 2 years ago. These are some of the things that people told us. We love this. It was thought-provoking, scripture-based, and practical. It's one of the best series I've ever attended. We're really glad that the church had the courage to deal with this subject. I love that Christ was honored and the messages were biblically focused. It was a very comfortable atmosphere that was created in all the sessions. It felt really safe. Props to apostles for getting the most qualified speakers to tackle this subject. And lastly, one person wrote, a lot of people we know heard about this conference and they wish they had been able to come. Please offer it again. So we heard you, and we are. So you don't want to miss out on this because messages about sexuality swirl around us multiple times every day through the media, through our culture, but rarely are those messages filtered through the grid of God's truth or in the safety and sanctity of the church. So you don't want to miss out on this because this conference really, something like this is truly rare, but it is so good you won't want to miss out. Your church is offering this to you free of charge, but you will need to register for it. And so you can register for the conference online at our website, or when you're leaving today, you can go out in the both upstairs and downstairs in the lobby. There are tables there where you can fill out a registration card. It might take you a whole minute to do, but you want to get registered for that. And any other questions you have would be found on the information card that you'll find also out in the lobbies. Hope to see you there.
Yeah, and I can just give personal testimony to one of the guys who's going to be leading that conference, Dr. Seitzma. He's been just a huge instrument of God in my own marriage, and Megan and I just doing counseling with him over the years, and what a gift to get to be around him, to hear him teach. I can't tell you what a gift this is that Apostles is offering you guys, so I hope that you'll take advantage. That's in 2 weeks. Next week, we have a cool thing starting up here that's going to be going through the summer, where we just have a kind of a coffee shop set up in room 229. And we encourage you to come a few minutes early to church and grab a cup of coffee with somebody, sit, and even after the service if you want, just to catch up before lunch. It's a great way just to connect with people in a busy world, right? And so 229 next week, that's going to be there. But here we are in this week, and before Josh comes, we're going to take the offering. We're going to do this song. I want you to sing it with us. I hope you'll know it. Beautiful song. It talks about our identity in Christ as sons and daughters of God because of what the Father's done for us in Jesus. Let's sing this together. It goes like this.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? It's not because of who I am, but because of what you've done, but because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, just a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, and you catch me when I'm falling. You've told me who I am. I'm yours. Who am I? By the eyes I see my sin. Me rise again. Who am I? That the voice that calm the seas would call out through the rain and calm the storms in me. It's not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, just a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, catch me when I'm falling. You've told me who I am. I'm yours. I'm yours. You have adopted me into royalty. In love with you, Father, I'm deep in love with you, Lord. My heart, it beats for you, precious Jesus, deep in love with you, Lord. We try that together. I'm deep in love with you, Abba, Father. I'm deep in love with you. In love with you, Lord. And to our brother and our Savior Jesus, my heart it beats for you, precious Jesus. I'm deep in love with you, Lord. Yeah, we just tell him this morning, deep in love with you. I'm deep in love with you, Father, Father. I'm deep in love. My heart, it beats for you.
Before I get into this morning's message, I want to make a quick announcement. Today at 1 o'clock, 1 p.m. Eastern, which is 7 p.m. Cairo time, you can log on to ltw.org. It's pretty easy, ltw.org, 1 o'clock, and you'll see live the sermon Dad's going to be preaching at the largest evangelical church in the Middle East, less than a block away from Tahrir Square, where the supposed Arab Spring took place. And you'll hear some Arabic music at first, so you won't understand what they're saying, but probably around 1:45 or 2 p.m. Eastern, you'll see Dad preaching in English with a translator. So if you're near a Wi-Fi spot at 1 o'clock, tune in to ltw.org and watch this morning, or this afternoon, evening for them. My scripture this morning comes from Romans 8, verses 14 through 17. And it is found in your Pew Bible, page 1757, 1757. I'm also going to be, I'm quite ambitious here this morning. I'm going to try to get through Romans 1 through 7 in about 10 minutes. It took Jim Ryman 2 years when he was alive and he taught class here, Digging Deeper. It took him 2 years. I'm going to try to do it in 10 minutes, so pray for me. But I want to get us caught up to today's verses. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory. This past December, I had a bit of an identity crisis. Not the kind of identity crisis you get when you're 35 and you buy a minivan. I kept reminding my wife the whole way home, I had a dirt bike in college, I had a Porsche, I had a 1976 Toyota Land Cruiser FJ55 with a safari rack. Not that kind of identity crisis. You see, 14 years ago, the Lord supernaturally rescued me out of a river in Alabama, saved the lives of me and three of my friends, physically, and spiritually brought me back to Himself. And I began to have moments in December where I was looking back on that time, not with a sense of maybe regret, but fondness. And how I had grieved the Holy Spirit in college. And how, like a dog that returns to its vomit, the Bible says that we return to our sin. And I found myself returning to this sin. And this friend of mine, this professor, we went out and he said, "It's not who you are." He reintroduced me to Romans 6 through 8, which I had just taken his class and it had bypassed me. I'd read it numerous times, and this professor said, "It's like we're having an identity crisis. We must reckon ourselves dead to sin and alive in God through Christ Jesus. We must recognize that when we sin, that's not who we are. It's an identity issue." Thus the title of my sermon. I've been working on this since December. I hope whether you are a Christian and you are asleep in your sin today, or you don't know God, you will come to a better understanding of that today. If you don't know Him, I pray that today is your day. That you're adopted. And if you do know him and you're stuck in the patterns of this world and the sin of this world, I pray that the realization of God as Daddy would become so real to you this morning. And that's been my prayer all week, really. This question of identity, let's take a macro view for a second. This question of this of identity in terms of the global question of identity is really broken up, in my opinion, into two camps. The Western camp, how we as Americans view identity. And there's an Eastern camp. And I'll get to the Eastern, but you know, in the West, particularly in America, we are a nation which prides itself on its independence. We're a pull yourself by your bootstraps country, right? You've heard that phrase, he's a self-made man. And consequently, our identity oftentimes is found in our achievements. It's found in our ability to work ourselves out of a problem. You know, a friend of mine observed this, and sometimes our identity can be found in really noble things, so bear with me. But this friend of mine from overseas, he observed, in America, fathers love their jobs and mothers love their children. That's not how it was supposed to be. It's a struggle. As men, we want to find our identity in our jobs. We want to find our identity in God, but we oftentimes feel tempted to find our identity in our jobs. And for mothers, it's so easy to find our identity in the achievements of our children. That's not how it was supposed to be. It seems today that our culture is having an identity crisis, a social identity crisis. And it's not just Western in America, it's global. For many, their identity is found on this social media page, what this Twitter account says about them, or this Instagram account that they post only positive things to. We're not who we really are on our Twitter account or our Instagram account. We're really living this double life. Sometimes I'm sending stuff to Twitter and my wife says, oh, I didn't know you aced that exam. And I, how'd you know? She said, oh, I saw it on Twitter. She has to learn about me, unfortunately, sometimes through Twitter. Someone recently sent me an article from the West Coast. It was about a spate of suicides in California, in Palo Alto, very, very wealthy suburb in California. You know, Google and Apple. And very talented, bright, smart kids. Nobody can figure out why they're throwing themselves in front of trains. And every possible cause is teased out in this article, except for one. The one I'm going to make today. One analysis is interesting, though. This comes from an English teacher at the high school. It says the kids are suffering from profound isolation and loneliness. His young ally agrees. Kids are living their whole life in this tiny little box. Martha says, as she refers to her near ubiquitous cell phone, I think that's where a lot of the depression comes from. There's no real social connection anymore. One of the high school students interviewed had this to say about the spate of suicides. Everyone wants to stand out because it's really hard to stand out here, says Haley. Consequently, anything that gets you noticed, being gay, being Jewish, even being inordinately sad, garners social capital at Gunn High School. Depression is effectively glorified, a senior says, because it attracts attention. Years ago, Dad and I went to a fundraiser in the Bay Area, right in San Francisco, and there were all these very wealthy people. I met a guy who had retired at the age of 40. I thought it was the coolest thing. Now I don't think it's so cool. These people have created what the world would call a utopia. Perfect houses. Perfect cars, perfect kids, perfect universities, and yet within this is this sadness. Within this community, there's like a loss of identity. You know, the Eastern notions of identity, think of like the Indian culture, for instance. The people at the bottom are called Dalits. It means they're untouchables. The jobs that they are to do are cleaning toilets, sweeping streets, and there's like five lifetimes that they could possibly get closer to the gods. So there's five stations between them and the gods. That means they have to be reincarnated like five times, and then maybe they get close to Vishnu. Their identity is in their birth. They are born into that identity, and it is nearly impossible to escape it. In fact, it probably is impossible to escape it. We deal with this in the Muslim world, this whole question of identity. In most Arab countries, if I showed you a driver's license or a passport, their religion, a person's religion, is on that ID card. If I took you to Egypt and showed you my cousin's driver's license and passports, it would say Christian. Ashraf, Christian. Tariq, Christian. If you're a Muslim, Muslim. It says your religion. You're born into it. So turning your back on this religion is like turning your back on your family, your community, and ultimately your identity. And this is why we see honor killings. The family is so dishonored that they would rather see the child dead than having this alternative identity, this alternate identity. And we see it even in Christian communities in the Middle East. Very young children to church, the church will take them and they will tattoo them, like I have here. I tattooed this cross on my wrist not quite 20 years ago. And I did it to represent and to connect with my forebears, the Coptic Christians, who tattoo themselves to distinguish themselves, to ID themselves as distinct from the Muslims, who over the last 1,400 years have done horrible things to Christian communities. A friend of mine went into a Lebanese restaurant recently, and he said to the guy, are you a Christian or a Muslim? The restaurant owner said, I'm a Christian, of course. He said, oh, when did you become a Christian? He said, 2,000 years ago. You see, to many in the East, their identity spans across generations. That's why sometimes Muslims will talk about the Crusades as if they happened yesterday. Both of these forms of identity, this Western identity found in work and achievement, and this identity of what you're born into, you stay in, this, what the community says about you is your identity, both are just equally crushing. What does all this have to do with this morning's text? A lot. Because I believe Paul is wrestling with this question of identity right up until he settles right into this adoption theme. And in chapters 1-3, and you can kind of flip through your pages or your iPad if you want, you can kind of keep up with me. In chapters 1-3 of Romans, I think Paul he's really chipping away at this identity. Your identity as a Greek or Roman, your identity as a Jew. And in 3:9 of Romans, this is what he says. He says, what then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. And here he says, he quotes Psalm 14:3. Paul says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one seeks God. It's like he's cut everybody off at the knees. He's leveled the playing field. He's saying, you are not as good. You're all the same. The ground is level at the cross. He has leveled any claim to individual or historical identity as a means of standing righteously before God. Your parents were Episcopalians? Who cares? Your father was a pastor? Greenpeace, Save the Whales, activists? Go stand between the preacher's kid and the Episcopalian. Ground is level at the cross. And now that he's leveled the ground, Paul says, I can now build on that level ground. And in chapter 4, he says, because he knows the Jews are going to say, well, what about Abraham? He worked. 4:13 of Romans, for the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. And Paul begins to build this beautiful faith argument. Verse 22, it states that this faith was counted to him as righteousness. In another letter, Paul in Ephesians 2 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no man may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. We are not saved by our good deeds. We are not saved by a little bit of good tipping the scales of the bad. We are not saved by our parents' faith. We are not saved by a denomination. We are only saved by the finished work on the cross. Now we're getting to the good stuff here. Because in Romans 5, Paul mentions something for the first time, and it is glorious. He refers to the love of God and the Holy Spirit. In Romans 5:5, he said, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, this is verse 6, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. But God shows his love for us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. He's introducing these beautiful words, grace and justification and reconciliation. He's roadmapping the way of peace to God and how it was accomplished by Jesus. And in Romans 6, and this is where this identity crisis is starting to brew, in Romans 6, Paul is saying we must die to sin. If we've died in our flesh and we've been raised, we must consider ourselves dead to sin. Romans 6:11, you must also consider yourselves. Some translations say, reckon yourselves dead to sin and alive in God, alive to God in Christ Jesus. Some translations you say reckon, almost like think yourself dead to sin. In your mind, you are dead to sin. Emily and I enjoy watching this show on Friday nights called Shark Tank. It comes on ABC. I can tell by the laughs that some of you are familiar with this show, but for those of you who aren't, this is a show about these billionaires that sit high, kind of perched up in their chairs, and these young entrepreneurs come forward, present their business plan and their how many sales they've had, and then the billionaires kind of fight. Sometimes they don't fight. Sometimes they just send people home. They fight over who's going to invest in this company. And there's this one guy, I can't even remember his name, talk about loss of identity. They call him Mr. Wonderful. He's about as wonderful as an actual shark. He is as tight as a tick. He has no compassion. And people will come, and he will make an offer. He'll say, okay, I'll give you X for 5% of your company. And when the person refuses, he says, you're dead to me. That's kind of his catchphrase, you're dead to me. In other words, go away. It's as if you're not alive. You don't exist. And this is how Paul is saying we ought to view sin. It's dead to us. And in the back half of chapter 6, Paul begins to set up this dueling slavery theme. He talks about slavery of sin and being slaves to righteousness. You're either a slave to sin or you're a slave to righteousness. Sin enslaves and leads to death, but being a slave of God leads to life through Jesus Christ. I have an Arabic friend in London. His name is Abdul Masih. He's literally slave of Christ. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. Sin, death. God, life. It's easy. It's really easy. Sometimes I think we complicate it when we talk about, oh, there's a hole in your heart, and there's only God can fill it. It's like, nope, dead, alive. Are you dead? Are you alive? Which one? And there's this wonderful thing happening where Paul is using words like obedience and sanctification. And you really begin to see that when someone comes with absolute, they have nothing to offer God because they don't. God scoops them up. Even in their perceived willingness, God scoops them up. He gives them the Holy Spirit, gives them new life in Jesus Christ, that they may be dead to sin and alive in Him. They may no longer do the things that they used to do, but do the things of the new life. And now comes the real identity crisis, and I'm going to read this to you. It's probably the longest passage of this morning's sermon, but it's Romans chapter 7, verses 14 through 25. Many of you are familiar with this. Romans chapter 7, starting at verse 14. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is the sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me, for in my inner being I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself, in my mind, am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. This almost sounds like the ravings of someone who's bipolar. Is he schizophrenic? This totally contradicts what he just said in chapter 6. He said, died to sin, freed from sin in 6, 7, and as we'll see in Romans 7, controlled by the Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 11, 1, he says, follow me, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. What gives? It doesn't seem to jive with what's going on in Romans 7. In my time at Leading the Way, being a member of this church, being a student at Reformed Theological Seminary, I find that believers oftentimes, they'll fall into really two extremes. They'll fall into what I call the wormology group. I'm a worm. I stink. If you plugged a projector up to my brain, you would be appalled at what you saw. I am a bad, 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 bad man. And then there's the blissfully ignorant. The blissfully ignorant, or the sin is such a negative word. They want to focus on every aspect of the Christian life other than confession of sin. Salvation, check. Heaven, check. Those warm, fuzzy, familial feelings that we get when we sing songs, check. Confession, repentance, and brokenness over sin, pass. You know, the problem sometimes, if we go back to the wormology people, the problem is sometimes is that they're in such mopey despair that they never really come out of their sin. They never show a change in victory over sin or a change of worldly patterns. They seem to get stuck in that mopey despair. And the problem with the blissfully ignorant is that they're lying. They're lying to themselves that sin is not in them. I want to share here that I believe that Paul in Romans 7 is not describing the typical Christian experience. I believe he's referring to someone who is trying to do good under the law. He's striving to do what is right, but he doesn't have the power of Christ and the Holy Spirit to overcome and break through. It's not Paul. I want to say today that if you're stuck in this Roman 7 gear, my prayer for you, and has been all week, is that you would change into, you would shift into that Romans 8 gear, and that you would have a real encounter with the Holy Spirit today. If you're having an identity crisis because you can't stop looking at those websites, if you're having this identity crisis because you can't put down the drinks, you're having an identity crisis because you can't stop blowing up at your spouse and your kids, today you can encounter that real identity. It's amazing. Paul, he doesn't come out of Romans 7 and say, get a hold of yourself, man up, get it right, man. Beginning in verse 1 of Romans 8, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. No condemnation. Paul knows that what he said in Romans 7 is heavy, heavy stuff. And the reader is no doubt feeling condemned and helpless. And so he comes out of the gate with, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And then he sets up this other theme, this dueling theme of flesh and spirit. No longer is he talking about slavery anymore. He's talking about the flesh and the spirit. And there's this beautiful picture, a glorious and incomprehensible image found in today's scripture. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him, we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Led by the Spirit of God, adoption, child of God, co-heir with Christ. What an identity. We are no longer orphans. We are no longer without an identity. And Jesus, in the Gospels, in John 14, 18, he tells his disciples, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. He's promising his Holy Spirit. And it is his Holy Spirit that brings us to that adoption, which brings us to that new identity. One thing you need to know about the Roman world at that time about adoption. Adoption was virtually purchasing a child. A poor family that is unable to make ends meet makes the grueling, difficult decision to give a child up or children up for adoption, and it's a legal process. It required steps that ultimately irreparably severed the relationship between the birth parents and the child. In the eyes of the law, this was seen as new birth. The child was born again. The past no longer has claim on the adoptee. If you want to understand Roman culture, you can look no further than The Godfather, the movie. Please don't write me angry letters afterwards. I introduced this series of films to my New Testament professor. Every so often he uses the examples because so much of the film, things, cultural things, have been going on for 1,400 years. And there's this story, there's this account, there's this relationship that happens in The Godfather where the Godfather, Don Corleone, you read about it in the books, but he adopts someone, a son, Tom Hagen is his name. He's played by Robert Duvall. and he puts him through law school, and he treats him just like the other children. Even though he doesn't look like them, he's like Irish, and they all look Italian. And there's this scene in Godfather 2 where the birth son, Michael, played by Al Pacino, he cedes control of the empire over to Tom in the event of his death. And Hagen has this really emotional response. He says, "I always wanted to be thought of as a brother by you, Mikey, a real brother. Even those in the mob crave identity. Our identity is adopted child of the Most High God. And we are thought of as a sibling, a co-heir with Jesus Christ who sits at the right hand of the Father. This is our identity. This is who we are. Nothing can change that. Nothing can alter it for those whose faith is in Jesus Christ. Abba, Father. The word literally means daddy. I used to hear preachers say, Abba is daddy. And I used to think, that's so childish. My kids call me daddy. I'm not going to call God daddy. But isn't that what Christ tells us in Matthew 18? He says, become like this child. Humble yourself like this child if you want to be the greatest in my kingdom. Paul is saying, you can call on your heavenly daddy day or night. He is able. I recognize that some of you have had terrible fathers, terrible earthly fathers, and I pray, please do not project that on our heavenly Father, because he's a good father. He didn't spare his own son. He gave his son so that we might have access to him. He crushed and murdered his son, his birth son, so that we would be adopted. And so we should be quick to repent to daddy. We should go to him and say, I'm sorry. There should be immediate repentance. We can cry out to him anytime. We don't make an appointment. There is no mikvah. We have to wash our hands and no ritual. I mean, we were at a playground just yesterday and my kid fell and busted her lip. And of course she ran after me, daddy. And I couldn't get to her fast enough. This is the relationship. This is the relationship Paul is describing. That is who we are. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we might also share in his glory. This is probably not a verse you're going to see on the next evangelistic seminar at Apostles. What is this suffering? Well, it takes on multiple forms. And one of the sufferings of this that we experience in this world, because this is not how it was supposed to be. Sin entered the world and caused all this havoc. One of the sufferings is this whole tension of sinner child that we feel, this identity crisis. Sometimes there's real persecution, and I could stand up here and tell you story after story. I have a dear brother in Erbil, Iraq, who we talk almost weekly, and I hear story after story of people suffering for Jesus Christ. Some of the suffering is the loss of a loved one. It's death. We just had a church member this morning that gave birth to a child, and 2 hours later, that child died. It wasn't supposed to be like this. Sin entered the world and made everything messy. But we have good news, because we have one who loves us so much that he came to reconcile us with God the Father. I heard a quote recently, if God allowed a perfect man to suffer terribly, why should we think that something like that could never happen to us? The good news is, it's only for a short time. If you read on in chapter 8, we're reminded of the completion of this adoption and the redemption of our bodies when Christ is going to make all things new. He's going to renew this earth, this awful fallen world. We celebrated some birthdays this week. My two girls are 2 years and 2 days apart. So we do the birthday week thing. That'll be cool until I think they're 13. And you know, you get nostalgic with the birthdays. You kind of go back and look at photos and videos. And I don't know why, I guess because I was working on this message, something came into my mind when our oldest was 2 years old. It was my first encounter with the fall, you know, sinfulness in a child and shame. And it was when she would do something wrong and we would discipline her. She would go take pillows from the den or her room or whatever. She would put these pillows on top of her. She would just hide under these pillows. Sometimes we'd walk in, we didn't even know what was wrong. We just saw the pillows and thought, okay, check the gas, check to see what she wrote on the wall, check my books, my seminary books, to see what she ripped out. And I would pull the pillows off one by one. And there was her red face, tears streaming down her cheeks. And after I had pulled the pillow avalanche off, I would deal with the issue, I would discipline her, but I would tell her that I loved her. And that I wanted her to know that she could come to me anytime. She doesn't have to hide under pillows. She can come to me because I love her. God's word says he disciplines those whom he loves in Hebrews. He disciplines us because he loves us. Nothing can change his love for us. Go to the end of 8, you see nothing can separate us from the love of God. The end of chapter 8 of Romans. Nothing can change that love. And I believe that there are people here today who are living under pillows. You have bought into false patterns of the world. You have bought into what the world has said about you, how sin has identified you. And God is saying, come out, come to me. I love you. You are my child. You can resume the identity that I gave you when you came to Christ. And as I said at the beginning, I think there are some here who don't know God. They think they know God, but they don't. They think they're a child of God, but they're not. I'm not trying to get you to question your salvation. But do you think that if I can just work hard enough, if I could just be like Michael Youssef, be good enough like him, that's not what earns you salvation. You have to come to Jesus with nothing. I want to pray for us. Let's pray. I think God's doing something in some of your hearts, and I don't want to quench the Holy Spirit. Whether you have known God all your life, whether you have been in and out of church, you love Jesus, but you're stuck in this pattern of sin, and you've bought into this false identity of what the world or what sin says about you, and you've tried to run away from this adoption, and you're having an identity crisis, I pray that the Holy Spirit would nudge you to stand up right now. If you thought you knew God and you thought it was about efforts and work and just straining and striving, you can stand up too. I'll pray for you. Whether you're asleep in Christ and you just this sermon helped wake you up, or you were dead in your trespasses and you want life, stand up. Lord, you're a good, good dad. You're a good father. And I pray for these people. I pray for people who wanted to stand up and couldn't stand up. They felt some pull not to, Father. I pray that in your time you would guide them to this right identity, to this right view of how we should see ourselves as your children. You're a good dad. The Bible says you give good gifts. You gave us your Holy Spirit, and if we're stuck in sin, we can just cry out and say, Lord, Holy Spirit, help me. Help me to overcome this addiction. My identity is not found in that. My identity is found in you. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus. Thank you for that peace that it brings us. We love you. Amen.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, that's who I am, that's who I am, that's who I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for as you call me. deeper still as you call, deeper still as you call, deeper still into love, love, you're good, good Father, it's who you are.
Sin goes back to the lie that God's not as good as he said he was. He's not as good as he said, so we have to take this for ourselves and go and run and hide and figure this out without him. First lie, it's still the most pervasive one. He's not as good as he said. And you might be like, good grief, can we please sing another song? But I'm just telling you, there's nothing deeper you could possibly sing than this is the heart of God. He's good to you. He has good plans for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, but to give you hope and a future. And not just a good wishing Father, an all-powerful one who's able to restore it all, redeem it all. Nothing's wasted. Nothing could separate us from the love of God in Christ. I was just reading this week in Deuteronomy, in the Song of Moses, Deuteronomy 32. He says, all of your works are perfect. All of his works are perfect. He's perfect in all of his ways. Not the bigger, meaner, stronger version of your earthly dad, the perfect version of your earthly dad. Just think in your own life, I mean, how much heartache could you have avoided if you would have lived out of this reality that you are deeply loved by the Father? You don't have to go find that. You don't have to go search for that. You've got it. You don't have to live for that. You can live from that. It would change everything. We are loved by you. That's who we are. It's who we are. It's who we are. We are loved by you. It's who we are. It's who we are. It's who we are. You're a good, good Father. That's who you are. It's who you are. We're loved by you. We are loved by you. It's who we are. It's who we are. It's who we are.
are is poetry. What more could I ever need than to know that He delights in me? We are His masterpiece, or His poetry. We are His poetry. What more could I ever need? What more could I ever need than to know that He delights in me?
Let's sing that together.
We are His masterpiece.
We are His poetry.
We are His poetry.
What more?
What more could I ever need than to know that He delights in me?
One more time.
We are His masterpiece.
Josh was preaching and reading from Ephesians and from Romans. Just thought, man, let's just try to sing it. We're the masterpiece of God, the workmanship of God, the poetry of God, created in Christ to do good works to the glory of God the Father. So may this week we live out of that identity. And anytime the enemy comes to tempt us to live out of old false selves and old lies, may we just remember, no, that's not how I am. I'm the poetry of God. I'm the masterpiece of God, made in the image of the living God, saved by the blood of our Savior, and being constantly recreated to be glorified one day in the presence of Almighty God. May we live this week in light of those realities, and may it show the world that the world too could have a really good father, a good, good father. God bless you guys. Thanks for being with us this morning. Y'all have a great day.
I pray that you had a fresh encounter with the living God as a result of worshiping with us.
Thank you so much for watching. We are so glad that we are available to you this way. Get in touch with us. We'd love to hear from you. God bless.